السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله بلغ رسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين أما بعد فإن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة بالنار أما بعد My dear respected brothers and sisters, inshallah, we're going to be continuing our series of how or the morals of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And today we're going to be talking about a unique moral of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in which that it applies to all aspects of our life, which is al-ihsan. Now the question is, how can we define the al-ihsan? Linguistically speaking, the word ihsan, as the Arabs would say it, is ضدul isa'ah. It is the opposite of anything that have any faults. Anything that have faults, the extreme opposite of it is al-ihsan. Or in another meaning is the word means in linguistic speaking is perfection. Now, as far as the contextual meaning of al-ihsan, as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have identified for us is أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تراه فإنه يراك. That you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if you are seeing Him. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not see you, then if you cannot see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then He indeed can see you. Now, when we talk about the khuluq, the moral of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how he dealt with ihsan, there is two things that, there is two branches of that. One is al-amal al-qalbi, the action of the heart, which is that you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you would see Him. And the second branch is the physical aspect of it, which is that you would perfect each and every aspect of your way toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear respected brothers and sisters, there is an elevated status of the khuluq al-ihsan. Ibn al-Qayyim, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, in the longest tafsir ever made about an ayah, Ibn al-Qayyim, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, he made the longest tafsir of one single ayah. And he called it Madaju Salikin Baina Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'in. So Ibn al-Qayyim, he made a whole of two-volume book that explains the verse Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'in. And he said, and this is what he said, that you know, in our way toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are stations that we go through. In our way toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are multiple stations that we go through. And he said, one of these stations is al-ihsan. And he said, وَهَذِهِ الْمَنْزِلَةُ هِيَ لُبُّ الْإِيمَانِ وَرُوحُهُ وَكَمَالُهُ. He said, and this station of al-ihsan, it is the core aspect of our faith. The core aspect of our faith is al-ihsan. وَرُوحُهُ, it's spirit, and even more than that, it's completion. So al-ihsan is something that is, if somebody is claimed to be a mu'min, yet he does not have ihsan, there is some sort of deficiency that indeed exists. You see? So this is the importance of this khuluq. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear respected brothers and sisters, have as he taught Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah كتب الإحسان على كل شيء. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have demanded of us to make ihsan perfection in each and every aspect of our life. And that's why you will see, for instance, there is a lot of coordination in many deeds of the Quran with the word ihsan. For instance, when it comes to patience, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَاصْبُرْ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ أَجْرَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And be patient. And indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not belittle the action of the people who are perfected. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have connected ihsan with forgiving. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَنْ عَفَى فَمَنْ عُفِيَ لَهُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ شَيْءٌ فَاتِّبَاعٌ بِإِحْسَانٍ فَاتِّبَاعٌ بِمَعْرُوفٍ وَأَدَاءٌ إِلَيْهِ بِإِحْسَانٍ. And whoever forgive, let him forgive with ihsan, with perfection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have connected ihsan with our struggle, with our nafs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظَ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّفْسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And when we try to forgive, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that you're supposed to be struggling with that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who are muhsineen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, when you are arguing with the non-Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تُجَادِلُوا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ إِلَّا بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. And do not argue with the people of the book except with what is perfect. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when there is fighting, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَلَا السَّيِّئَةُ ادْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. And if there is fighting between two people, what you should do? You should act with them with perfection, what is better. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the way we deal with each other, when we say salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذَا حُيِّيْتُمْ فَحَيُّ بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ مِثْلِهَا. And if somebody said salam to you, you should return the salam with something that is ahsan, that is better, that is perfect, and etc. So therefore, ihsan is... It is something that is connected in each and every aspect of our life. Whether the way we deal with each other, the way we talk with each other, the way we say salam, the way we forgive, the way we deal with the non-Muslims, and etc. So therefore, there is a huge gap. Because thing is, it's one thing to do the action. It is one thing to do the action. But it's a whole different level for you to perfect it. And that's what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had indeed done. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had perfected his relationship with each and every aspect of the people that surrounds him, with his wives. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not just treat his wife with the best of way. He treated them with the perfect way, in which that he felt for them. He cared to have a smile in their faces. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made sure that he treated his wives equally, and etc. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, look at how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam treated his neighbors. Not just they are my neighbors, but no, with the uttermost way of perfection. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawm al-akhir, falyuhsin ila jari." Whoever believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hereafter, let him treat his neighbor with the best, with the most perfect way that is possible. So, and not only that, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at, you would not find such morals, such treatment in any other religion except in our religion. Look at what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said when he dealing with his neighbors. He said, وَإِذَا طَبَخْتَ مَرْقًا فَأَكْثِرْ مَاءَهُ ثُمَّ انظُرْ أَقْرَبْ أَهْلِ الْبَيْتِ مِنْ جِنَارِكَ فَأَصِبْهُمْ مِنْهَا بِمَعْرُوفٍ. He said, if you cooked a soup, increase its water so you could share this soup with the closest neighbors of yours. Prophet Muhammad, look at that. Just for you to make sure that you're connected to them. Not just you're eating, make sure that you're connecting with your neighbors. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look what he asked the believing woman. He said, يَا نِسَاءَ الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ لَا تَحْقِرَنَّ جَارَةً لِجَارَتِهَا. Oh, mothers of believers, do not belittle anything that you give to your neighbor. And this is what he said. وَلَوْ فَرَسَنِي وَلَوْ فَرِسْتَ بِشَاهِ. He said, even if you give them bones that have little meat. Even if you give them bones that have little meat, that it's okay, just give it to them. So subhanAllah, nowadays, the way we are disconnected from our neighbors, subhanAllah, there is even now animosity between neighbors. There is, barely someone would say hi to their neighbor. Maybe, whether it's Muslims or non-Muslims, and etc. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time, Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked, قالت يا رسول الله إني لي جارا فأي أيهما أهدي. He said, I have two neighbors. Which one I should give my gift to? Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إلى أقربهما بابا. He said, the one that is closest door to you, the one that has the closest door to you, then you go ahead and give them to them. So again, that shows us how not just treating our neighbors with good, not with the most perfect way possible for us, for them, because this is our right toward them, and etc. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my dearest brothers and sisters, one time, there is one thing that you commit a sin against an individual. It's one thing to commit a sin against one individual, but a whole different level when you commit that same sin against your neighbor. It's not, yeah, like for instance, the same exact sin. If you do it to anyone else, it may be counted, you know, at one time. But when you do the same sin against your neighbor, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. It is multiplied multiple times. Look at the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said. He said, لَإِنْ يَزْنِ الرَّجُلْ بِعَشْرِ نِسْوَةً أَيْسَرْ لَهُ أَنْ يَزْنِي بِمْرَأَةِ جَارِهِ. He said, if a man, it's easier for the man to commit adultery with 10 women, better than him to commit an adultery with his neighbor. With his the one of his neighbor. And the same thing. And it is better for someone to commit 10, stealing things 10 times, better than him that he is, you know, stealing from his own neighbors. SubhanAllah. Look at the, not just the normal treatment, but look at the delicacy. How Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam treated his neighbors with the uttermost perfect way possible of how the neighbor should be treated. And again, this is show you nothing but how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam conducted his way, his moral to us in the most perfect way. Not only that, look at how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with the lowest people of the society. Like for instance, the poor people and the orphans. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Yani, look at this." Yani, brothers, now when we asked about, for instance, when we asked about to deal with the orphans, people nowadays say, well, I'll give them money. But you know what? What is the most perfect way of dealing with the orphans? Because thing is, you know, giving money, خلاص, I give the money and then you know, they're going to go and I'll go my own way, right? But I'm telling you, what is the most perfect way of dealing with the neighbors, with the orphans, is that she marry their mother. Because this is a responsibility nowadays. Now, these orphans have a stepfather that they look up to. Now, these orphans have some sort of protection that is going to take care of them. Not just financial protection. A man in the house who will fight for their rights. A man in the house who would tell them bedtime stories. A man in the house that would make sure each and every day there's a dinner and lunch in the home. So, you know, giving money, it's easy. Wallahi, it's easy. And yes, it has its own reward. But even more difficult, and the most perfect way of us to deal with orphans, that someone would marry the mother of these orphans. And that's exactly what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. When Ummu Salama, the wife of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, her husband died away, he came to her to marry her, not because of the fact, not for other reason, than for the fact that he know that Ummu Salama was a righteous woman, and he know that she had orphans. And Ummu Salama, she told our Prophet of Allah, you know, she agreed, but she said, I have two issues. One of them, I have orphans, and I am I'm a woman who's extremely jealous. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I will make dua for you, for your jealousy, and I will take care of your own children. And this is the best way of dealing with the orphans. You know, yes, it is good for you to pay money and give these orphans to take care of them. But it's a whole different level. A whole perfect way is for you to take care of their family day after day. And that's what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have indeed taught us. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have taught us that, you know, that if when someone takes care of an orphan, you're not getting any sort of reward. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, look what he said. He said, "Ana wa kafir al yatimi fi al jannati hakada," and he pointed with his index finger and his gun finger. And he said, "I am with a person who take care of the orphans in Jannah like this." Subhanallah. This is not shows you that again. It is one, you know, it's to encourage us to take care of orphans, to encourage us to make sure that we take this extra step and perfect and make a life of another individual normal and etc. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time a man came to him and look at not just financial aspect, but only it's also a spiritual aspect. A man came to him and said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, my heart is hard." كان يشكو قسوة قلبي. He said, "My own Prophet of Allah, my heart is hard. You know, how can I fix it?" Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, look what he told him. He said, "Imsah ala ra'si yatim wat'im al miskin." He said, "Rub a head of an orphan." Rub the head of an orphan and feed the poor. You would, you, all this, this hardship would go away immediately. And again, that, this is not just, again, just feeding the people. You know, throwing the money at them. No, it's even an elegant and a more delicate way of perfecting our dealing when we deal with the people who are needy. And that's exactly what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. In another narration, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِذَا أَرَدْتَ أَن تَلِينَ قَلْبِكَ فطعم المسكين وامسح على رأس اليتيم. If you want your heart to be soft, you know, feed a miskin and rub a head of a person who is needy. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, look at this. Even not only the regular poor people, but even the widows. You know, how did Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have dealt with the widows? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, الساعي على الإرملة على الأرمة والمسكين كالمجاهد في سبيل الله. He said, the one who go after the needs of an orphan and a widow is as he is fighting in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he is fighting. And again, that shows us, you know, taking care of the people who are in need, taking care of poor families. It is not just taking care of them, but treating them in the best way possible. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was dealing with the poor people, يعني look at, يعني again, to show his humbleness, to show how much he cared, look what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. He said, Allahumma ahyini miskinan, wa amitni miskinan, wa hshurni fi zumratil masakin. Oh Allah, look at the dua of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, oh Allah, make me live as a poor man. And make me die as a poor man. And make me, when you gather the people in the hereafter, gather me among the poor people. Again, that shows us, to show us how to elevate these people. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at what he said. In another dua, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allahumma inni as'aluka fi'la al-khayrat. Oh Allah, I ask you to do the good actions, وحب المساكين, and for me to love the people who are poor. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time in another hadith, he said, قمت على باب الجنة فكان عامة من دخلها المساكين وقمت على باب النار فعامة من دخلها النساء. He said, to show us the value of these people. You know, sometimes nowadays, people look at these people and they're like, they're just, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them get a job or something. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed us the value of these people. Maybe these people are 1,000 times better than you. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I have stood in the front of the door of Jannah and I saw the majority of the people of Jannah are the poor people. And I stood in the front of the door of the hellfire and I saw the majority of the people of the hellfire are women. And the question is here, why women? Because nowadays people say, you are racist, you're against women and etc. You know, it's simple. Who are the majority of the people who live in the world, women or men? Down the line in the future, who is going to be the majority of the people living in the world, men or women? It's going to be women, obviously. So the thing is, but who are the majority of the people who are in the Jannah? That's the question, people who are poor. يعني Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, هَلْ تُنصَرُونَ وَتُرْزَقُونَ إِلَّا بِضَاعَائِفِكُمْ. Wallahi, this hadith should shake people. Nowadays, unfortunately, the word of who gets to the top, the word of who gets the most credit, the word of who the people pay attention to, the people of the poor. How much are you donating? How much money in your pocket? How much can you give us? This is what really matters nowadays. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, look at what he said. He said, "Hal tunsaruna?" From where are you going to get victory, other than people who are poor and weak among you? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to give victory, He might give us victory because of the poor people. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might give us, make us successful, maybe if a poor man who never had anything in his pocket and he never donated to the masjid, because of that one man who is sitting in that corner, because of his poor clothes, is maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give these people success. But nowadays, subhanallah, things, we might able to twist
the religion
because of somebody who have more money to put in his pocket. And this is the reality of the situation that we live, unfortunately. Subhanallah, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed us that these people, poor people, a way for us to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The value of these people, and these people could be the most blessed and the most honorable in the hereafter. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just generally speaking now of al-ihsan, and inshallah we're going to conclude with this. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allah katab al-ihsan ala kulli shay." Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have taught us to do perfection and do ihsan in each and every aspect of our life. If we, even when we slaughter an animal, we slaughter him with perfection. When we want to treat a tree, we treat it with perfection. When we want to speak to an elderly man, we treat him with perfection. If we want to treat our children, we treat them with perfection, and etc. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allah katab al-ihsana ala kulli shay." That indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written perfection each and everything. وَإِذَا قَتَلْتُمْ فَأَحْسِنُ الْقِتْلَ. If you slaughter, then slaughter it in the best, most perfect way, most honorable way, easiest thing that would not show any harm on the animal. فَأَحْسِنُمْ وَلِيْحِدَّ أَحْدُكُمْ شَفْرَتَهُ. And make sure that they would sharpen their knife. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ فِيمَا بَقِيَ غَفَرَ لَهُ مَا قَدْ مَضَى. And this is another important hadith, and inshallah we're going to end with this. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man ahsana fima baqa, whoever perfected what is left." Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Waman asa'a fima baqa, akhada bima mada wa baqa." That whoever perfected, again, all of us have mistakes. Maybe we did horrible things in the past, but the question is how we're going to act in the future. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us, whoever perfected from this point on in our lives, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive each and everything that was done in the past. Just perfect whatever was done in the future. But in the opposite, he said, وَمَنْ أَسَاءَ فِيمَا بَقَى. And whoever, you know, messed up whatever left of his life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to account him for what is going to be in the future and what's in the past. So again, this is kind of a warning in which that we have to change in the way that we deal with each other. We have to make sure that we perfect our way in dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahi al-azim, my dearest brothers and sisters, when it comes to worldly things, and again, we try to perfect each and everything. We want to make our cars look beautiful. We want our houses to look beautiful among all the other houses. We want our clothes and our smell to be beautiful. We want our shoes to be shiny. But when it comes to a prayer, we pray any prayer. When we want to come to donating, we donate to anything. If we want to fast, we fast and we do everything, many things that are sent and exact. What is the ihsan in our life? In which that we perfect each and every dealings, and that's the way, once we perfect our actions in everything that we do, then it's going to reflect to the very first thing that I said, that أن تعبد الله كأنك ترى. That you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it's going to affect your heart, in which that you would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you would see Him. And if you cannot see Him, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see you. If I said that there is anything that is appropriate for myself and the shaitan, and if I said anything that is good from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa a'udhu billahi min shaitan ar-rajim. Just a quick note, inshallah, maybe this is like the end of the akhlaq of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Next week, with Allah ta'ala, because of the time change, we're going to do it after Maghrib. Because next week, the time will change. And we'll start a new series with Allah ta'ala, in which that we were talking about the physical actions. But inshallah, and this is something that I've been preparing for some time, is going to be the actions of the hearts. So this is extremely important. Things for us to purify our hearts. And jazakum Allah khair, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all of you.